linguistic art chips.
Greetings from Cyberdelic Space. This is Lorenzo, and I'm your host here in the Psychedelic Salon. And it was just 5 years ago today that I posted my first podcast from the salon, which means that this is the first program of our sixth year together. And if we're not careful, we're soon going to be in a long-term relationship, at least by today's standards. Now, before I do anything else, I would first like to acknowledge the woman without whom I would not be here today, my dear departed mother, who would have been 95 years old today. Happy birthday, Mom. I love you. And some other people I would like to thank right now are Tyler S., Colin F., and Michael H., all of whom sent in donations to help offset some of the expenses here in the salon this week. So thank you very much, Tyler, Colin, and Michael. And I would also like to thank you, for without you, why, it would be pretty lonely around here. And I think you should also know how unique you are. After reading down the list of titles from all of these podcasts over the past 5 years, I'm actually quite amazed at how many people there are around the world who are interested in the same things you and I are interested in. Let's face it, a lot of our friends, relatives, neighbors, and coworkers probably think we're nuts to be spending our time listening to these philosophical lectures. But here we are, together once again in the Psychedelic Salon, trying to push the boundaries of our minds ever farther to the outer reaches of thought. Or, as in my case, hey, I just like listening to this stuff, and I try to not put a lot of thought into why I'm wired the way I am. I'm just happy that you and I seem to be resonating at some level that feels right, that feels like we're doing whatever small things we can to keep our species on an even keel as we navigate these treacherous waters ahead. So, how's that for melodrama? It's the best I can do right now, because what I really want to do is to listen to this talk once again. And the talk I'm referring to is a conversation that took place between Myron Stolaroff, Gary Fisher, and a group of friends at the legendary salon that Kathleen hosted on the third Friday of every month in Venice Beach, California. Sadly, these salons ended a few years ago, but at least I have a recording that was made on the evening of March 19th, 2004 that I'm going to play for you right now. And since I've already done several other podcasts that featured either Gary or Myron, I'm not going to reintroduce them to you now, because I'm sure you already are well aware of the significant contributions each of them made to the early scientific research in psychedelic medicines. And if you've heard my audiobook, The Genesis Generation, then you already have an idea of what those salons were like, because Chapter 9 takes place at one of Kathleen's salons. Basically, they were give-and-take sessions between the speakers and the audience. And in this case, I now find it tragically ironic that in the very beginning of their talk, Gary and Myron are teasing one another about having memory problems. Sadly, today Myron is now suffering from dementia and essentially has no memory of the past anymore, which makes this recording even more precious to me, because we'll never hear Myron tell these tales again. And so I'm glad that I more or less forced the two of them to lead our discussion that evening. Kathleen and I had been trying to get them to do that for a year or more, but they always found some excuse not to. Then, about a week before the March salon, Kathleen called me and said that her speaker had canceled at the last minute and asked if I knew anyone who could fill in. Well, I knew that Myron was already planning on attending, and since my wife and I had already planned on bringing Gary with us, so they simply couldn't wiggle out of it this time. And then at the very last minute, I realized that an evening like that may never come again and should be recorded. So I called my friend Jarrett, who borrowed a video camera and drove all the way across L.A. to get it to me in time. And that tape, which was in high 8, sat on my desk until recently, when I finally got around to asking my friend Alan Lindell to digitize it for me. And eventually I'll get the clips from it up on YouTube, but right now, we're going to hear the audio from that evening's salon for the very first time, thanks to Alan, Jarrett, Kathleen, and of course, Myron and Gary. So now let's travel back in time to one of those magical evenings at Kathleen's salon and listen to Gary Fisher and Myron Stolaroff tell us a few stories that may help us shed a little more light on the early days of our current psychedelic resurgence. And by the way, by the end of this discussion, they finally make it to the funny stories. of which I'm sure you have many of your own. Now, I'm going to just jump right into the point immediately after I had introduced Myron and Gary as the evening's entertainment. But keep in mind that both of them were also regulars at this monthly salon, and so it wasn't like they were new to the crowd. Okay, you guys can take it from there.
Myron's going to talk for a while about himself, hopefully, and Al Hubbard. And after he's finished, then we're going to take questions from the audience. But while he's talking, we don't want to interrupt his train of thought, because he'll never get back to it.
My thoughts disappear this fast.
I know, because I got the same syndrome. I was a little disconcerted to get a call from George Bush earlier today, and Myron's been appointed sainthood.
Bush is about to do it.
Well, he's the Pope. And so I don't know who this guy is here. I thought I knew him. Myron, let's start.
Okay. One of the questions that Gary asked me, and which I hope you all be interested in, is how did I get mixed up with Hubbard in the first place? And it's really a fascinating story to me, anyway. But I'd gotten acquainted with Gerald Herder in Southern California, who's one of the world's really great mystics and a marvelous author, if you've read his books. And I was very taken with him, and I was with Ampex Corporation and went to Southern California frequently, and every time that I went down there in business, I tried to see Gerald. So one time I was visiting him, and he started telling me about LSD and taking it, and what a remarkable thing it was, and all the openings that it provided. And I thought, my God, what's a mystic doing taking drugs anyway? So I didn't do much more about it. But then Alex Poniatoff was the head of Ampex Corporation, and he'd gone to Canada, and somehow or other he'd run into Hubbard. And he came back and told me all kinds of stories that Hubbard had told him about the work he was doing. So I thought, well, gee whiz, maybe I'll get in touch with him. So I wrote Al a letter, and much to my amazement, two or three months later, there he is on the steps of Ampex. So we got acquainted, and I was sucked in immediately. He's a very gregarious person, full of fun and laughter. And the thing that got me, I was all shut up inside myself and worried about this and that and the other thing, and I could never really feel anybody. But in his presence, I could feel his warmth. And especially as I got to know him and spent more time with him, I just thought it was great just to be in his presence. And he's full of stories and all kinds of interesting things. So it only took that one meeting for me to make up my mind that I wanted to go to Canada, where he lived, and have LSD. And my first LSD experience was just absolutely remarkable. So I think I was ventured to say right off the bat that that's the greatest discovery man has ever made. Of course, I don't know much else what the man discovered, but as far as I'm concerned, I'm willing to stand by that. So that's how I got into it. And Hubbard came down, introduced him to some folks, some that he got along with, some that he didn't. But in the end, I just saw that I had to spend the rest of my life as much as possible in doing something about LSD. So I used to visit him quite a bit. He got together with Ross McLean in Canada. Ross McLean was a psychiatrist who had a mental hospital. And they administered LSD there, and I visited him there. And after a while, I got to the point where I felt we had to do something, and so we started the clinic in Menlo Park, where for 3.5 years, we gave people LSD, some mescaline, a little bit of psilocybin at times, until the FDA finally put a stop to everything in 1965. So that's how I got in.
And Myron, tell us how Al Hubbard, how did he get a hold of LSD, or how was he introduced to it?
I'm not sure exactly who the people were that he got involved with. He did run into someone in the Vancouver area who introduced him to LSD, and it only took one shot with him. He had an amazing opening, a tremendously spiritual experience, and he felt actually he'd been given a mission to really spread this around. Fortunately, at the time, he was very well off financially. He had a very close friend who was wealthy, who he gave LSD to his friend, and his friend had the same kind of opening and was willing to support him in anything that he wanted to do. So he began to devote a lot of time meeting people, getting acquainted, and he was very good at sizing people up and assessing whether they'd make good candidates, and he was very good at supporting people through the experience. So he began to spread the word around, and he covered an awful lot of ground.
My connection was secondhand to him because my mentor was a guy by the name of Nick Shalalis, who was my brother-in-law. And he was a research psychiatrist at the University of Saskatchewan. And at the time, they were studying LSD, and it was called at that time a psychotoma medic, mimicking psychosis. So they were giving people LSD, thinking they would discover what were the structures and the dynamics of psychosis. And Al went over and said, it's easy to make people crazy. What's hard is to make them sane. And LSD will make them sane and won't make them crazy. But if you give it the wrong, if you don't give it in the proper environment, it will make them crazy. And so that's how, and I don't know how he got to the Saskatchewan. It was called the Saskatchewan Group on Schizophrenia. That was the name of their project. And that was Hoffer and Osman. And then my brother-in-law, Nick Shalalis, and then his partner, Duncan Blewett. And I had my first experience there with them in 1959. Before any of you were born. And I got born that day that I had my first session. And Myron, why don't you tell us a bit about the work that was done at Menlo Park?
Well, I'll be glad to do that, but I'd like to interject a little bit of what you just said about Duncan and Blewett, because I'm not sure how the connection was made, but Al went to Central Canada and met with Hoffer and Osman, and he'd heard about their approach, which really wasn't recognizing what LSD would do at all. But somehow he met Blewett, and he's very sensitive, and Blewett's a very open, warm person. He recognized right away that Blewett would be a good candidate. So he gave Blewett LSD. And he was off with Osmond and Hoffer, and he went in and looked at Blewett, and Blewett was just having the time of his life. So he went out to see Hoffer and Osmond, and says, you know, this guy Blewett is having a psychosis. You better come in and see if you can get him out of it. So they walked in, and immediately Blewett started laughing, and Al says, see, can you get him out of it? And he would just laugh all the time. Well, anyhow, Hubbard worked with McLean at his hospital there for several years, and I got to visit that. And then Hubbard, well, he's not an easy guy to get along with. So he very much likes things his own way, and so I'm not sure what the conflict got between he and he and McLean, but he decided to set up his own treatment place in downtown Vancouver. And that went on for a while, and I thought, gee whiz, we ought to do the same in Menlo, in California. So I put the necessary things together. Fortunately, I accumulated a little cash, and we set up a place where really was set up pretty much the way Al designed it. Very nice furniture, comfortable setting, beautiful pictures on the wall, a lot of artifacts for people to look at to stimulate them various ways. And then, of course, one of his main tricks was to have people bring pictures of their family, their parents, their siblings, their marriage partners, and so on. Because looking at that under the influence is tremendously revealing. And he had several really good pictures, too, that actually one just really opened me wide open. Well, I don't know how much time
same, is that same on. Veronica's veil?
Yeah.
Just familiar with that. Oh, hell. I use it thousands of times. It's worn out. Well, Al was a Catholic. And so it was the setup that I created for my work was exactly what they had in Menlo Park, because it's what they had in Saskatchewan. So we were all benefactors of Al's insights. And it's when, my understanding is when Christ was carrying the cross, he fell, and Veronica wiped his brow with her handkerchief. And then it was and then the next day on the handkerchief was the image of Christ. And there's this awesome painting called St. Veronica's Veil. And most powerful thing. We used it every session. And, you know, when they used it with me, I was not happy with Christians, I'm telling you. I mean, I had a family of Christians and they were all kooky. And so I wasn't about to look at it, you know. But Nick, you know, every hour or so, he'd pass it to me again. Well, I'm not ready for that. You know? And so finally, thank God, I looked at it. And it was an overpowering experience to experience what Christ's love is. And I was astounded. I was absolutely astounded. So that was worked for me, and I thought if it works for me, hell can work for anybody.
Well, you're certainly right in my case. I'll just elaborate briefly. I've covered this in the book, but I looked at this figure, and one of the things about it, it was one of these pictures where you look and the eyes are open, and then you keep looking, the eyes closed. Did that happen with you? So I saw the eyes closed, and oh my God, something's wrong with me. Why is he closing his eyes? Because the picture, when you're under LSD, is so alive. It's almost like a living person in front of you.
It is.
And so I looked again, and then all of a sudden, there was a swish. And I was looking at a female face. My God, what's happening here? And then all of a sudden, swish, another face. And then, in the next few minutes, 1,000 faces of all variety of mankind went by. And I said, this is every man. I'm Jewish, mind you.
You were Jewish.
I was Jewish. That's well put.
One of the things I suppose you all know, but you may not, but in that era, nobody had a clue what LSD was. But a funny story, when I was working with my group of kids that I worked with, I was working at a hospital in Costa Mesa with schizophrenic and autistic children. And I thought, well, hell, if it worked with me, it can work with anybody. So I told the psychiatrist in charge, I said, I want to give these kids LSD and see, you know, what will happen. And so, what's LSD? Well, you know, this is the name of it. Well, is there any literature? No. And so he sort of trusted me. And so we just got LSD from Sandoz and started using it. And But nobody knew what it was. So, you know, there weren't any committees or evaluating what we were going to do. We didn't know what we were going to do. I didn't even have a clue what I was going to do. But one of the funny things, I was telling somebody one time that I was doing this work, LSD work with these children, and the guy looked at me and said, "You're converting children to Mormonism?" I said, no, LSD, not LDS.
He clearly had a learning disability.
He needs it.
So the environment was absolutely wonderful. Laura Huxley, Myron and I both have known Laura forever, and she made the comment one time, we didn't have any Baptists because we didn't know you could have Baptists. So all the input that we ever had from anybody was how wonderful the experience was. So we didn't have any set that it was other than positive. And what a blessing that was, because it hadn't gotten anywhere. It was totally unknown. And there were a few groups around the world that were using it. A friend of mine in Holland was using it. And another friend of mine in London was using it. So we would all find each other somehow, because there wasn't any internet in those days. Word gets around. And one of my best friends came to be Joyce Martin, who was an analyst in London, and out of the Tavistock Clinic, and she did incredible work. And Aronson Heim in Holland, incredible work. He had his own hospital, and that's all he did was LSD work, and just awesome kinds of results. And then I was going to say Leary the devil, but I won't. Long came shit, and they hit the fan, and then we were all closed down. So then we did it all, well, some of us did it without government approval, I guess you would say. Do you want to make any other comments, or should we ask people for questions?
Let me just mention one more thing with regard to Hubbard. That I think his going to mid-Canada, to Hoffer and Osmond, and the demonstration with Blewett really opened their eyes, and I think it really was the beginning of people beginning to discover what LSD could do. And they went and started doing a variety of programs, and Twellis and Blewett worked together for several years with alcoholics. And then other hospitals in Canada were trained and did it. So I really think you have to say that Hubbard was an enormous factor in LSD being properly recognized for its true merits and work proceeding. Actually, in America, they're harder to convince, and I don't think they caught on nearly as well as the Canadians did. There are a few that did some pretty good work in America, but by and large, I think you have to give Hubbard a lot of credit for getting the thing moving.
Myron, you wanted to read something, didn't you?
Well, I could at this point. What I was going to, you know, Hubbard is such a fascinating guy, I thought I would read several things to show you how different people saw him. First, I might start off with the fact that, now, I have to say here, I don't know exactly whether any of this stuff is true, because Hubbard was quite, he was all over the map. But he claims that he never wore shoes till he was 13 years old. And then at the age of 22, he was in the water near Seattle, and he had a boat that was driven with something that he invented. And a lot of people went out and saw that, and it was in the local newspapers there. And Hubbard claimed that it was a perpetual motion machine that he himself had claimed. The people looked at it, nobody could figure it out. There's no way to say that it wasn't so, but the thing is that boat went all around for long periods of time without any apparent fuel. And then he sold, I don't think there's a connection. Some people say there's a connection, but I think independently, he came up with some kind of a gadget that he sold for $75,000, which at that time was a lot of money. And then he said he found out afterwards that whatever it did worked so well that it was worth a great deal more money than what he got for it. Anyway, I'd like to read a little bit about how different people saw him. I think one of the first, he and Blood became very, very good friends. I'm going to read out of this book here. This is a letter that Blood wrote to Hubbard. He says, "Hello, ye old goat. Whose old uncle..." You know, my eyes are against the back. I can hardly read this. Okay.
Where is it?
Starting right here.
Okay. I'm mostly blind. "Whose old uncle forgets him and never, never writes him a letter? My Uncle Al, that's who. What are they doing to you these days that you neglect your fat nephew? I've been watching the incoming mail, meeting all the aircraft, and reading all the police news regularly in hopes that I'd catch some glimpse of a letter from you, yourself, or your name in headlines." Now, you get the reference from the police news. This, Al was a magician, wasn't he?
He definitely was.
Yeah, he was a cosmic jokester. He was a funny man.
But he knew how to make the right connections.
Yes. "However, despite my vigilance, there hasn't been the slightest indication that you're still alive. If I didn't know that it would take a battalion of enraged grizzly bears to do you in, I'd have been so worried I wouldn't be asleep by now. There's another picture that floats through my mind eye. In fact, a whole series of pictures of Al basking in the sunshine of some Pacific isle, watching ball games in Wichita, catching huge fish off Boca Grande, and generally living a life of idle bliss. How about a few lines of communication to let me know if we still fly the same flag and what the latest developments have been? All the very best of good wishes. May the sound of police whistles cease to annoy you and become music to your ears." Oh, that's where that was too, you know, like jokester to jokester, yeah.
And here's a statement from Aldous Huxley. This is excerpted from his book, Moksha. And this was, this was a letter that he wrote to Humphrey Osmond. He says, "I am hopeful that the good captain..." Oh, incidentally, Hubbard made himself captain. But he did have a 120-foot boat, so I guess he's entitled.
Well, he was captain of a good ship Lollipop, right?
So, "I'm hopeful that the good captain, whose connections with uranium seem to serve as a passport into the most exalted spheres of government, business, and ecclesiastical polity, is about to take off for New York, where I hope he will storm the United Nations, take Nelson Rockefeller for a ride to heaven, and return with millions of dollars. What babes in the woods we literary gents and professional men are. The great world occasionally requires your services," this is Osmond's, "is mildly amused by mine, but its full attention and deference are paid to uranium and big business. So what extraordinary luck that this representative of both these higher powers should A, have become so passionately interested in masculine, and B, be such a very nice person."
It was very interesting, too, to see sort of the net, how LSD was networked around the country. It did get into very well-known people were turned on by Claire Booth Lewis, was one of them. And she had quite a remarkable experience. And I don't know if you know, like Henry Lewis, he was a pretty, broomstick up his ass kind of guy. And so she gave him acid. And he was a very devout Catholic. And she said he was 15 hours on his knees praying that he would survive. And a lot of the Hollywood people got involved in the networking. Cary Grant was one of them, particularly. But there was a... people, heads of different kinds of industries, I was familiar with. I had turned on a few of them too. And it was very interesting how, like one session would change a whole company was run. I turned this guy on. He was really a toughie, but he had something there that he was intrigued by. My whole attitude, he couldn't figure out what. And I said, well, I was an uptight, really. I mean, all I was one big IQ walking around before I could. It was just like I was nothing but brain. And I was a basket case. And so I told him that. And I guess he thought, well, hell, if it made you into a human being, maybe it can make me into a human being. And it did. And he owned his own company, and he changed that whole company around, where people were teaching people below them what their skills were and what their knowledge was. So everybody in the company was teaching somebody below them to take over their jobs eventually. It was an amazing thing, and they didn't have hours anymore. People would come in and work when they wanted to. And it became a real family. And this was from one guy taking LSD. All the employees never had LSD. Make that clear. But just from that he owned the company and the changes that he instituted. And of course, I was very instrumental in suggesting to him what kinds of things could be done. The atmosphere in that place was just amazing. And there was another place down in San Diego where the guy who owned the company was turned on, and he also changed his whole company the way the whole thing ran. And then they started doing profit sharing, and they just became like a big extended family. So there's all kinds of history.
Seems like we could use that today in today's corporate atmosphere.
Government. Hal Burton.
what was the name of the company?
They need to IV that over there.
What were the name of the companies, if you don't mind?
No.
Just curious.
Are they still around, these companies?
I know the owner of one died, so I don't know if he sold it before he died or not.
I think your idea of asking what people might want to hear.
Yeah, believe it or not, I was a professor at one time at UCLA of all places, and I never lectured in my life. I would just ask people, what do you want to know about? And then people would say what they wanted to know about, and that's what we talked about. So I thought that we would do the same thing, ask people, well, what do you want to know about?
Has there been any follow-up work done with the autistic children that you gave LSD to?
No, because what happened, the project was closed down, of course, because we couldn't use it anymore. And so when I went back to try to find out what was going on, they did not want to have me there, because at that time it became the evil drug. And so when the administration recognized that that's what we've been using, they were terrified. We had made a record of every session for every child. And I think we did something like 83 sessions. And so we had complete notes from every session, what was in the child's chart. They had taken all those out and burned them. and denied that it ever happened. So, because they were just, you know, terrified.
What were the results?
Tell about the results a little bit.
Yeah, what were the results?
Are their names still recorded, or did you lose that too?
Well, yes, I know their names now.
Okay.
What were the results of the puzzle?
Right, what were some of the things, the results?
Well, what was so remarkable was that, now I should tell you a little bit how sick these kids were. They were in a back ward in the hospital. They did not relate to each other. Many of them were in camisoles 24 hours a day, tied up because they were violent. Most of them didn't communicate. Many of them just did the whirling and bumping into themselves and other people. The place was pandemonium. It was like cartoons of like Bedlam from the Middle Ages. It was just trying to keep the place clean was all the staff could do. There wasn't really any treatment for them. And, you know, this was in the very early, this is the late 50s, so they weren't any of the medications available either. Well, the first patient that we did, the psychiatrist, he said, I said, well, like, who should we start with? And he said, well, Nancy, she's dying, so why don't you start with her? Because if she dies, you know, there won't be any loss because she's dying anyway. She had what was marasmus, where she was so withdrawn that even if they injected her with nutrients, her body wouldn't absorb them. She would slough off anything. And she was just skin and bones. She weighed, you know, like 40 pounds or something, and she was black and blue. She looked like a skeleton, and she was 11, and she was tied down 24 hours a day, because if she was let loose, she would tear her eyeballs out or, you know, gnash herself. So that was our first patient. I thought, God, you know. And so I thought, well, I was always a, you know, a risk taker. So, you know, I gave them the same doses that we were giving adults. I didn't give them any less. We were using 500 mics with them. Because the idea was, you know, you have to use enough to get the jet propulsion going so that they don't get into conflicts. That you just, like, they don't have any control over stopping it. And so she started feeling the effects of it after about 20, 25 minutes. We did it IM. And so she started groaning and howling. And we had a room set up where we did all our sessions. It was actually the visitor's room that we used for sessions. And she started howling. It was like an animal that was wounded. And howled and howled and howled. It was treacherous to listen to it. We would hold her, do everything under the sun, nothing. And so finally, after about 6 hours, my frustration, I took her and looked at her and just screamed at her, Nancy, how fucking long are you going to scream and moan like this? I can't take it anymore. And she stopped and looked at me, and she had a lisp, and she said, Gowie, I have a long way to go, so just leave me to hell alone. And she went back to howling again. That's the first communication she had ever made with anybody. That's
wow.
It. And from then on, boy, what a trip we had with her, because she was so bright, and she was a challenge. But, you know, after a number of sessions, she was having experiences like Aldous Huxley would have, you know, like... you know, like it was one day we were going down, and she said, well, the kids all knew when we were going to have a session. All the kids that were in the project all wanted to be their turn. You know, they didn't want to wait. And so she was bustling down there and getting in there. And so one of the other kids was trying to get in, and she said, She says, you don't belong in this room. This is where we get to see God. And they would verbalize. They would verbalize completely. And they would talk about you know, we're all one and God is love and, you know, all the stuff that people talk about. And these were kids, you know, young kids who were, had never been functional in their life. So it was amazing. They had the same results that anybody else had. It took, because they would go back, you know, you go here, and then you come back, and you know, but we did as many as, I think, as many as like 19 or 21 sessions or something like that.
Gary, can you tell a story about the girl that you had to tell that it was being shut down by the government? And
oh, yeah. Oh, that was awful. She was an amazing gal. I just adored her. She was about 14. Very, very... She was crippled, and she was blind. And her skin was all diseased. And she was a twirler. And all she would do was twirl all day long and bang into things. And she would sort of warble as she twirled. And she was always black and blue. So every once in a while, you know, she would have to be tied down for a while because she would be so self-destructive. She had the most awesome experiences that I've ever sat with of anybody. I mean, she was amazing. I'll always remember her hands, because when she would break through into transcendental consciousness, for lack of a better word, her hands became healing hands, and I'd love to just sit there and have her touch me. It was just awesome to feel her. And all the sitters wanted to be in on Patty's sessions because we got so much out of it, and she would touch us, and she was wonderful. And she became very functional. She stopped all the twirling. She talked coherently. She would help other kids on the ward. She would try to help them, and she was blind. But she became a real caretaker on the ward. Well, finally, when we couldn't do the sessions anymore, I had to tell all these kids. So I had to tell her, and so she listened, and she said, "Well, do you know who has LSD?" And I said, "Yes." She said, "Well, what's his name?" And I told her. "And where does he live?" Well, I said, "He lives in San Francisco. He's the rep for Sandoz. We got all our LSD straight from Sandoz." And she said, "Well, I have an idea that it just might work. You go up and find him, and you tell him that you're there with a message from Patty Simpson. And Patty Simpson says, please give Gary some LSD because Patty Simpson really needs it." I mean, just remembering that just, you know, throws chills up my spine, because how do you tell kids that the government is fucked? Crazy. You know, any of those government people could come and talk with these kids.
This is a question for both of you. I'm curious what commonalities you found in people's experiences since you got to work with so many people. Are there any things that you would consider really universal or highly common or versus uncommon experiences that people have had?
Well, that's a pretty complex question, but the first thing that flashed in my mind, when we had people come in for a session, we told them that they'd be listening to music part of the time and they could bring in some of their favorite music. And there are an awful lot of people that said that brought in only popular music, and they didn't care to listen to classical music. But when they got into the session, we'd asked their permission if we couldn't put a piece of classical music on. And the results were that every single one who objected to classical music, after they heard it under LSD, that became their favorite music.
I have to tell you a cute story about that. And if, none of this is true, by the way. friends, I was at friends of my house, and they had had some mushrooms, and they had a one of these big dogs, like a Newfoundlander, but what's another really big dog?
Great Dane.
No. St. Bernard. Yeah. And you know what they're like. And so he came in, and someone had left some of the mushrooms on the table. Of course, he ate them. So we're all sitting around, you know, wondering, like, what the hell happened? We didn't know any antidotes for it. And so he looked a little groggy after a while, and he went and lay down in front of the stereo. Dvorak's New World Symphony was playing. Every time after that, in all other days, he would go up to the speakers and wag his tail and bark. He wanted to listen to the New World Symphony. So, you know, that wasn't a controlled substance. It was a controlled experiment, however. And, you know, these little funny incidents that happen.
Did you play
for him,
or did it bring it back for
him?
That's fun.
You know, like, you listen to music that you've had exquisite experiences. You listen to music, and why are you gone? You know, it takes you to the same place. Yeah, music was an amazing, potent thing that we used all the time. What was interesting, too, was that, like, I usually had, well, at least three sitters, sometimes four sitters, if the guy was really big, sometimes six sitters. Because sometimes when people would get into a fear state, they could be combative, and so you have to sit on them. And, where did I go with that one?
You reminded me of one, though.
I got one.
We had a guy, he was an officer in the Army, and they'd sent him to Stanford University for some testing, and somehow or other he heard about us and he wanted to go through our program, so he did. So he was in the room there. We always have a male and a female sitting with the person. And sometimes maybe the doctor go in too once in a while. We had outside the session, and we had a little kitchen where we prepared stuff, and I was in there doing something or other. And they came dashing in. They said, "Oh, this guy's name was Joel." I said, "Joel, he's getting out of hand. He wants to leave." So I get out in the hallway, and here he comes, this great big guy. He's about a good foot or maybe 2 feet higher than me, and he comes marching out, and I said, "Get back in there." And much to my amazement, he just turned around.
Okay, I recovered it. If we were sitting in a session, nobody's saying anything, but we could, you know, you follow where they are because you get out of your own ego state and you join the person whoever's taking the acid, and you go with them all the time so that you know where the hell they are, so when they get in a tight space, you know it. They can be totally silent, but you still know it. I would get up to go and to change the record to something else that would get the guy out of where he was stuck. Often, three of us would get up at the same time. We'd all look at each other, and one would go over and pick up an album cover and show it, and the other two would say, "Yeah." So all three of us were tracking exactly the same moment to know what music we should change to get him out of that spot. Mm-hmm. Really interesting.
But the question you asked, I think, also is kind of difficult because people are very, very different. They come with different problems. And then, of course, as time went on and Larry began to get people scared. It got harder and harder to get clients coming. And so we really saw quite a spectrum of things. And some, of course, what you're always looking for is a person who makes a real breakthrough. And if you do make a breakthrough, you know, you're getting to common ground. You know,
yeah.
That other place, as Walter King likes to call it, that other place, that's a phenomenal place, and it's wonderful to all be there. But not everybody can get there, especially the first time. So there's a lot of differences.
Yeah, in my experience, the transcendental experience is absolutely the same for everybody. Like when you have a complete and total ego death, then everyone has the same experience. It's the same thing.
Can you describe that?
Yeah, describe ego death.
It's lovely to have one every morning.
A moment ago you were mentioning about tracking with a person and you kind of recognize where they're going. Did you have any experiences where people, where you found that the people, that one person would think something, the other person would think the same thing? I mean, what would be called psychic experiences? You know what I'm saying? Like thought transference are the same.
When say there are three sitters and everybody's focused on the person who's taking the drug, then all four of you have the same consciousness all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Because you've left your own ego. And in order to do that, you have to have a lot of acid experiences yourself so that you're not afraid of that. To really absolutely not exist. Now, there is some kind of monitoring that's going around that you're not aware of. For instance, because then you get up and go change the record. So there's got to be some kind of consciousness that's monitoring things to guide you what to do to help that person. Or sometimes it's just going and taking the person's hand and holding them. But it would always be the same. Everybody would have the same response to what the person needed at that time. And one time we were sitting in the group, and I thought I had to go pee, so I got up and came back and sat down. I still had to pee. So I said, somebody in here has got a full bladder. So nobody would opt to it because I don't think they're into their bladder at the moment, but I was. And so I made each one go, and about the third person, I said, ah, yeah, that's not good. I think that's psychic.
I think so.
Whatever became of
Al Hubbard?
I was going to say a question.
It's working.
What are you taking? Did he ever get any legal trouble, and where did, how did he end up?
Or is he in hiding and we can't
be? Well, let's see. This is going to take a long time.
Myron has him.
Talking about legal trouble. Well, he did a lot of different things. One of the things he did that he set up radio contact with ships that were coming in and bringing whiskey in and arranging to put it on shore for him. He would dispose of it. Unfortunately, they caught him and he was in jail for 18 months. So that's one side. On the other side, later on during the war, he was very helpful to the government and helped in a lot of different ways. Ask your question again. There's something else I'm not getting at.
How did he end up? Is he still alive?
Oh, yes. he died in 1982. He was 81 years old. And actually, the latter years of his life were really pretty bad because you know, he made a lot of friends. He introduced people to these things, and you can hear from what's being said, the openings that people got, and they just absolutely loved him. He was a great storyteller. He was full of fun. But then, at a certain time, something happened to him. I think I was with him when it happened, but he had gone to Hawaii. He'd met a very wealthy woman, and he'd given her LSD, and she had agreed, she says, to loan him $100,000. So he thought everything was behind him, that God was behind him, that everything was working, and he could do what he pleased. And as a matter of fact, I think he moved into a state of inflation, and he began to really lose it, some of the kindness and considerateness of others, and trying to set up things to be more important. He made connections with Teledyne and high people there, and who made connections with the government, and they were going to try to convince the government to take over programs and so on, and none of this stuff worked. And one of the things he thought that he could do, as a matter of fact, sometimes he would, it was a favorite thing to drive people to Death Valley under the influence of LSD. And that's a marvelous trip. I highly recommend it. And then what he would do is from there he would take people to Las Vegas and gamble. And he felt that under LSD he knew where to put the chips and so on. And he actually, for a while, he did pretty well. But I think he got greedy. And then for a while he started losing. And he began getting behind in money, and he was still clever enough to get quite a bit out of me because I hadn't waked up enough yet to see what he was doing. But he really chipped me out of quite a bit over a period of time, and then he would get mad at people, and the last end life was not good.
I tease Myron mercilessly. I said, well, what he was trying to do, Myron, is wake you up.
Boy, did he.
Because, you know, in Zen it says the devil is in the employ of God. And he was the devil. And he played, he had all these roles. And Myron talking about this, I was just cracking in hysterics because Myron was offended that he manipulated him and took advantage of him. And I thought it was hilarious.
See, my buddy, I have a real close buddy that was a very close disciple of Hubbard, and they were close, but he didn't have my neurotic tendencies. So he really learned an awful lot with LSD. So Al would come and he'd start telling one of these stories, there's a guy here, if we can do this, and he'd pull out his wand and say, okay, Hubbard, what do you want? Take what you want. So he knew, but I was bitter.
We wanted him, you know, when you want people to be just one thing, they bite you in the ass.
Did you ever do any work with John Lilly, or did he fit into this circle?
Well, well, I didn't. I knew people that were close to him, but I didn't. But
no, I did not either. I knew of him. I'd met him. And I guess he was pretty decimated by the work that he was doing with dolphins, you know, in Florida. And he released them all because, as you might remember, they were all trying to commit suicide because they were so unhappy. And I had an experience of that too in the Waimanalo in Hawaii. They were doing interspecies communication. Gregory Bateson, I don't know if anybody you know Gregory Bateson.
Yes.
And he was married to Margaret Mead. And they were doing that too. And I went over and actually got in the tanks with some of the killer whales. And they were trying to commit suicide and very depressed. And had some interspecies communication with them. And they said if they had to live this way, they'd rather be dead. And so they started releasing, I was going to say, their guys who were unhappy, the dolphins that were unhappy, they left them out too.
That's also referring to, you know, he was doing the samadhi tanks, taking LSD and going into the sensory deprivation tanks.
Speak louder.
John Lilly was doing research on himself.
Yes.
Shooting LSD and then going into a sensory deprivation tank.
Well, the sort of general notion that most people have is that he got in very unusual states and could not transition, that he got pretty dysfunctional. Did he die, Myron, do you know?
Oh, yes, he died a few years ago.
He's been here. He's been a guest here. Mm. John Lilly has been a guest at this gathering. Oh. He couldn't speak. He was here.
The last time I saw him was at Oz's place that we heard with the gathering.
I'm curious as to when you lost the LSD for your study and what happened to the kids afterwards. Did they hold the improvements that they'd made in their lives, the autistic children? Or did they... Do you know what happened to them?
No, not all of them, because when I went back, I was persona non grata, so it was very difficult for me to get any information. I know that before I left, two of the kids were had been discharged to their home and were going to public school. Mm-hmm. There was a school within the hospital, and some of them were attending that school. One of the problems is that many of the parents of these kids were very, very disturbed people, and it's very hard to place children who have that kind of history. So we were just absolutely devastated about what to do. I mean, our first response is, well, we're going to adopt them all and take them home.
Right.
Well, some of us were married and had three kids at home already, and sometimes the wives weren't that open to having a house full of schizophrenic children. At that point, they were more sane than my own kids, probably. It was awful. It was a terrible, it was an awful experience. Losing contact with them.
But at that point, you say they were functioning better?
Yes, many. We started with, I think we started with 12, and we just couldn't handle 12. And I think then we did intensive work with 6 to 8 of them. And they all really had remarkable recoveries.
All of them for this year? They all improved?
No. Some of the... we had one kid, she was like 3 years old, and she never talked. And she during sessions, we never got any feedback from her. But she was always very isolated. Always couldn't stand to be touched. And of course, during sessions, we would always be touching them, constantly touching them. And so after about 3 sessions that she had, whenever any of the LSD staff would come on the ward, she would run to us and touch us and want to touch us and hold hands with us all the time. So we knew, although she had no speech, she had never learned to talk. We knew that something had happened because she was always wanting just to be touched all the time. But she was very young, and she we don't know what kind of brain damage she might have had either. But we didn't have any kids that didn't have an obvious change. No, that was the least change that any of them showed.
Did figures no statistics saying that we had 100% improvement rate in the
destroyed it?
Did that not? Did you show any of your statistics to any government officials?
They destroyed it.
Well, let me answer that. Did everybody hear the question? Okay. Let me answer that question with. It happens to be a true story this time. I was doing work at Cedars of, oh God, I almost said Cedars of Lebanon, I guess I won't, with terminal cancer patients. And the head of oncology there got a hold of the head of psychiatry and said, is there any way that we can help people with intractable pain? Because we've tried all the medications in the world, and these people are still having terrible pain. And so this fellow knew that I had done quite a bit of work with LSD. And this was still early in the game. And so he said, would you be willing to see these people? And man, I was willing to take anybody on, you know. I mean, just give me some, you know, people to work with. And so the first patient was one of their worst patients. She was very neurotic, very unhappy, terrible attitude, and had pain all the time. And she had advanced cancer. So she had one of the most remarkable experiences I've ever seen. Just had a complete breakthrough. And her whole personality changed. She did a lot of work after that with her family and so forth. But the next day, I went to see her and I said, well, like we talked about it, I said, well, how is your pain? She said, I don't have any pain. And I said, wonderful. And she says, do you have any idea, like, how long it's going to be that way? I said, no, I don't have a clue. You're the first one we've done. And so then the oncologist came back and said to her, well, how are you, and so forth. And she said, he came in because she had refused her pain medication. She told the nurse, I'm not going to take pain medication if I don't need it. It makes me constipated, makes me, you know, upset stomach. I'm not going to take it. So he came in and said, why aren't you not taking your pain medication? And she said, well, because I don't have any pain. He said, you're having pain. Don't lie to me. You're lying. She says, no, I don't have pain. He said, I'll go get the x-rays and show you on x-rays where you have to be having pain. And she basically told him that he knew where he could shove his x-rays. So he discharged her and she fired him at the same time. So it was a mutual. And so he called the head of psychiatry and said, I don't want Dr. Fisher treating any more of my patients because he makes them psychotic. And he said, well, what do you mean they make them psychotic? Well, this woman who is full of cancer now thinks she doesn't have any pain. So, you know, she's psychotic. And so the psychiatrist said, well, would you rather have them psychotic and not have pain, or would you rather have them normal and have pain? He said, I'd rather have them normal with pain. So, you know, talk about statistics for the establishment. Forget it.
What happens is
that how can they deal with that reality? You know, if you don't understand something, you say the person is psychotic. I mean, that's what psychosis means in our culture. Somebody's crazy if you don't understand them. I mean, everybody uses the word crazy to say, I don't understand this person. They're crazy. He couldn't deal with the phenomenon that he knew that she had pain, and why wasn't she having pain? His solution was, she's psychotic. It's a total natural conclusion he would come to. He didn't come and say, what the hell are you doing with these people that you're getting rid of their pain? Tell me about it. You know, let's do 20 of them. No. He had to maintain his notion of reality. Yeah. And we saw that over and over and over.
Well, you should have given him LSD.
I don't know if you can answer this question, but can you theorize or describe the physiological reason that LSD would alleviate such severe pain in somebody? Like how what's a mechanism by which a psychedelic can create that? A miracle, really, because, you know, a lot of people are in a lot of pain. It would be nice to have an out.
Yeah. Yes, I do know how you do it. Because I experimented with myself. And just all of this, the things that are going on neurophysiologically continue to go on. What you cease to do is to respond to it. And what you do is focus on the sensation. And by focusing on it and totally embracing it, you neutralize it. You neutralize it, and it becomes just sensation. It's like white light. It has no positive or negative valence effects to it. And I experimented that with myself by getting centered and then going this way with pain, and this way with pain, and this way with pain, and this way with pain, until I got to the bottom. And then finally you get to the point where it's so intense that you either tear your hair out or accept the pain, you embrace it, it becomes neutral, it becomes the sensation. But to do that, to have that capacity, obviously you need to be in an altered state of consciousness. And after you've had, you know, a whopping dose of acid, that stays with you for, well, the first time I had acid, I was in that state for 8 months. I didn't come down for 8 months.
Wow.
I didn't sleep for 8 months. Uh-huh. I had no need for sleep. But then I started getting back to ordinary reality. I had a shock. And you can teach people under those states these, you know, you can tell them how that works. You know, how that works. Well, maybe everybody's had enough of it.
Oh, no,
no.
No, we're just thinking.
We don't want to hear more funny stories.
Yeah, funny stories. Like, what's the funniest story that you can think of that happened?
Where did Kavanaugh get his acid? Didn't he have some kind of government source or something?
Who did you ask?
Captain Al.
Where did Al get his
Al was very good at making connections with people. Like, Harry Allhouse was the Sandoz person in San Francisco.
God,
and
yes.
Hubbard just knows how to seduce people. He and Allhouse became very good friends, and he was able to get LSD. He would make friends in Canada with people in important positions, and they would get it. And then he made a connection with Czechoslovakia and got LSD from Czechoslovakia. So he was completely different.
Where can we get some?
I'll tell you a hilarious story.
Let's hear a great story.
When we finished, we had access to Sandoz LSD in Switzerland. And so a bunch of us got together. There were about 10 of us in the project. And we all got our money together. And now I don't remember why this guy went to Vancouver. Anyway, he went to Vancouver, flew from Vancouver to London, from London to Frankfurt. Somebody in Frankfurt went to Switzerland and got the acid because it was like under the table sale. And we got a lot of it. And so then went back to Frankfurt, London, Vancouver, came across the border in a car and so forth, got to LA. At that time I was working in Hawaii. So my portion they sent to me. And they put it in, they said we put it in shaving cream. And so that's how it's packaged. So I got it and I opened up and there's all this shaving cream. Well,
You mean the actual liquid was mixed in the shaving
cream? No. Good idea. So I took it all. I was living in an old abandoned hospital at the time I was working for Peace Corps. And so all this stuff, I thought, well, I'll just go. I thought the shaving cream, you know, was the the cushion for it. So I took it and dumped it all in the toilet, flushed the toilet. And it was all in the bottom. I dumped the whole...
Oh my God.
And I realized I was hysterical for a week. What a cosmic joke. What a cosmic joke. So
I learned
from that, well, okay, it's meditation time now.
Somebody's really happy in that sewage treatment.
Yeah, heavy fish.
New species of fish.
Well, I want to thank you two guys for coming out.
Do we have to end it?
I don't know. It's up to you guys how long you want to stay here. But I promised Gary I wouldn't keep him out too late tonight. So I still want to get a few more things out of him, so I have to kind of hold to my word.
Byron, are you up for any more questions? Or maybe nobody has any more.
I'd like to know, I'm fascinated with the results you were getting, and could you talk a little bit about your medical past? I mean, you were working in a clinical setting, and I'm studying medicine, so that's why I'm asking. I'm fascinated with what you do. So what are you a doctor?
I'm a psychologist. And yes, the hospital we worked with the children was a hospital, and the guy who was medically responsible was a psychiatrist. He would never take it. He didn't. He just said that he wasn't, you know, ready for it. But he was like wonderfully supportive. He used to come and sit in on the sessions, and he was just amazed at it all. So he was a wonderful guy. But then the other LSD work I did, well, at Cedars, I did work there with it. And then most of all the other places, well, I also did work in London with it, with a friend of mine who was a psychiatrist. And then in Holland as well. Well, Charlie, should I tell him the story about the guy that took the acid and nothing happened?
Are you talking about this youngster? Oh, that is a fabulous story.
Well, this was the world's... He considered himself the world's most difficult psychiatric patient. And he was probably in his mid-20s. And he had been at Menninger Institute. He had been at Austin Riggs. All the big top-notch psychiatric facilities in the country. And nobody could help him. His father was head of a very big corporation in LA. And so the kid could never compete with the father, but he could become the worst psychiatric and that he was completely untreatable.
What was the diagnosis? I mean, what was untreatable? What did they say was wrong with him?
Well, he had all of these, you know, very amorphous symptoms. You know, he couldn't sleep, he had, you know, depression, I mean, just on and on and on. You know, he was very bright, and he would read all the psychiatric textbooks, and he'd come up all with all these diagnoses. He was in psychoanalysis for 7 years at Menninger's, and he didn't budge an inch, because he had to prove that he was the world's most untreatable patient. His father found out about me and asked the head of psychiatry at the hospital, you know, if I would be willing to give him LSD. And so I said, hell yes, I've never turned anybody down. I didn't care about his sister, you know. To me it was like, we'll get in there. And so he came, and I tried to prep him for it. Paid no attention whatsoever to what I was talking about. You know, and then, yeah, blah, 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 another drug, you know. He had every drug known to man. So we gave him 600 mics. and first of all, he was just sitting there, and so then he said, I think I'll lie down. I think I'm going to have a little rest. And I said, well, good idea. Well, he just went through holy hell. I mean, he shook, he perspired, he was throwing up. I mean, he was just a mess. I would sit with him and try to hold him, and he'd push me away. No, no. I'd say, what's happening? Nothing. Nothing's happening. Oh, okay. This went on for hours and hours and hours. And at the end of about, well, I guess we were there 18 hours. And he was in a hospital, so he stayed overnight. But he was just, he looked like death warmed up. And so I said, well, I'll come and see you tomorrow morning. He said, well, nothing happened. Well, it's okay. It's okay. So I came the next day and so forth. And so, you know, he went discharged home. He told his parents, you know, that nothing happened. And so I met with the father and I said, well, something definitely happened. But Richard doesn't want to acknowledge anything of this. So what we'll need to do is to try to do more sessions with him. And give him more. Give him more dopamine. So the father said, anything you can do. And so, so I went back to the hospital chief and said, no, we're not doing this kid anymore. You can't, we won't let you do it here. So I called my friend Anderson Hine in Holland and told him that I had this guy. I said, can I send him to you? Will you do it? And he said, no, but if you come, you can do it here. You can do it under my auspices. So I met with Richard and said, well, I said, the bad news is that we can't give you any more LSD here. And he went, thank God. And I said, but the good news is that I found a place in Europe that will allow us to do it. And these people are very knowledgeable and have done it for years. And so we can go there and do it. He said, oh, my father would never go to that expense. I said, your father's already approved. He went, oh, my God. Because he wasn't about to take LSD again. And so I said, so would you be willing to go? And he said, no, I couldn't go by myself. So I said, no, I'm going with you. He said, you're going to come with me? I said, yes. He said, well, how long are you going to stay? As long as I need you. He looks at me. He hadn't met anybody, you know, who had teeth in him like I did. So he said, well, I have to get back to you. And so I'll let you know when I'm ready. So I would call the house. Now, this kid had not been out in his house for years. He stayed in a room in the house with an attendant 24 hours a day. He had three round-the-clock attendants. And he was in a darkened room that he lived in all the time. So I would call and his mother would answer and I said, is Richard in? She said, no, he's gone out. I said, oh, where'd he go? He doesn't say. And so I'd call about a week later, is Richard in? No, he goes out every day. I said, did you tell him to call me? And she said, yes. I said, he doesn't return my calls. He says, I think he's going out, so he's not here to take your call. It's a long, a wonderful, wonderful story. I never saw him again. He moved out of the house. He moved into his own apartment. He got a job. He got a girlfriend. He went to college.
Wow. All to avoid you.
Well, something must have happened then, huh?
Something must have happened. And I'm always
just dying
to know. Charlie Grove had the greatest idea because this was published in one of Maps. And so Rick Doblin's always wants follow up. So Charlie said, well, do you think you could find him and do follow up? And I said, oh, yeah, after 30 years, I'm knocking on the
door. That would be hilarious. Do it.
Knock on his door and say, hey, you know, he's been tripping for about 18 hours.
And
find him and do it. Find him and do it. That would be awesome.
Yeah, it's interesting the different ways that people use life experiences. Yeah, it really is. It's wonderful.
Do you know if any of the kind of work that you both have been doing is being done at this time in other countries?
Do you know of any places doing LSD work today?
Only surreptitiously. I don't know. I think Germany was getting a little interested, but I don't know if they've really started anything. I think there's more talk. I think, you know, we now have 3 approved projects in the United States, so that's a big step forward. Nothing's happened in 30 years up till now. So I don't know. I think some inroads are being made, and especially if these projects turn out well, I think we'll start seeing some openings.
Why do you think there's that change? Why are they suddenly, after 30 years of nothing happening, why are they suddenly allowing research again?
Well, you'd have to ask the people who are in there now. I don't know, they've just been adamant for a long time, but you know, other people have been working away and trying to get results. And I guess
Charlie probably knows better than anybody here why.
It's the persistence.
We're very stubborn. we just persisted, and you know, it's taken many, many years to get these approvals, but you know, we're finally wearing them down. And,
well, the other thing is the evolution of age. The people who are now in decision-making positions, some of them took acid in the 60s. You know that they're doing
much too. So
yeah. Some of them didn't inhale. Yeah.
Some of them snorted.
Yeah, there you go.
What are the other 2 projects? There's the one I heard about at the beginning of the night, and I haven't been to some meetings for a while, so I don't know what the other 2 projects are. That you just mentioned.
Oh, the 3 projects.
Yeah.
One is Rick Dahlman's project with MDMA. There's Charlie's project with psilocybin. And then there's another one with obsessive compulsive disorder. That's also psilocybin.
Oh, that's great. Thank you.
As far as I know, those are the only 3.
I'm thinking that what we're hearing about ibogaine and ayahuasca and how they're using that with crack and heroin addictions, it probably is a similar, you know, sort of.
They only mentioned about ibogaine. The 2 clinics have opened up in the past year out of this country, and there's no research going on. They're just straight treating people clinically. There's a clinic in Mexico and a clinic in Vancouver. And the people running these programs are both going to come to a conference in Palm Springs in June to present what they're doing. That's the ITA conference in mid-June in Palm Springs.
It's May.
What?
It's in May.
No, it's in June.
Maybe there's another.
It starts June
13th.
International Transpersonal Association. This is an organization Stanislav Grof runs. Grof was one of the most prolific researchers for many years. He was in Czechoslovakia and Maryland. And the website is www.itaconference.org. Something like that. Some very.
Okay, we're cooked.
Thank you so much.
Let me just say, it's wonderful to come here to be with you, dear boy. It's just
thank
wonderful.
Thank you. You feel that way too. Just so everybody knows, by vote, I count up, it was a close call, but by 1 vote, Fish Stew won.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Barry and Myron, can we have the peace sign for the camera? The peace sign?
Sorry. I keep getting that one.
You're listening to the Psychedelic Salon, where people are changing their lives one thought at a time.
Wow, that sure took me back. To me, it almost seems like that conversation took place last night. As I listened to them with you just now, it felt like I was still sitting there in Kathleen's living room. I almost said in Caitlin's living room, because that's the name I gave her in the Genesis generation. And if you've heard that chapter already, I think you now know that I wasn't exaggerating about the raucous crowds we had on those wonderful nights. Ah, Kathleen, there is no doubt in my mind, but you were the hostess of the greatest L.A. salon that's been seen for many a generation. And since you're considerably younger than I am, I'm sure that we'll see you hosting another great salon yet again one day. And by the way, near the end of this talk just now, when you heard Gary ask someone named Charlie a question, that Charlie was Dr. Charles Grobe, who at the time was doing the psilocybin research with cancer patients at Harbor UCLA Medical Center. And I would like to add that at that time, my wife was Charlie's research assistant for that study. And when she retired, she and Charlie very wisely replaced her services with those of Alicia Danforth, who you have also heard here in the salon in earlier podcasts. So, you see, in a way, it's all in the family. Our extended family, that is, and it's the one that you most definitely are also a part of. And wasn't it interesting to hear Myron speak just now of only three psychedelic research projects that were then taking place in the States? And while there aren't all that many more today, we have at least progressed to the point where 1,200 professional people came together a few months ago for a psychedelic science conference, something that wasn't in the range of possibilities just 6 years ago. So maybe we are making a little progress after all. Now, you may remember from an earlier podcast that I did with Gary Fisher that he mentioned that he had given me the one interim report that survived about the autistic children's experience in using LSD as a possible cure. And I'll be sure that a link to that paper appears along with the program notes for today's podcast in case you want to follow up on what the results were. And maybe I should also add that in Gary's list of headlines about the various kinds of work he did with LSD around the world, he managed to omit the fact that he was also with Dr. Timothy Leary at his compound in Mexico, on the various Caribbean islands they were kicked out of, and at Millbrook, where he left not long after Ken Kesey crashed the party. And I think that most of those stories are already documented in past podcasts that I've done with Gary, in case you're interested in hearing them. And by the way, if you go to our new Notes from the Psychedelic Salon blog and scroll down the right column to see Gary Fisher's category, a click on that link will bring up all of the podcasts I've done with him and either stream the programs there or download them. And along with the program notes for this podcast, I'll also post a scan that I made of that painting that they were talking about, Veronica's Veil, the one that they stared at while on LSD. It's actually the same one that Myron used at the Menlo Park Institute back in the day, and he gave it to me a few years ago, and it still remains one of my most precious possessions. Now, before I go, I'd like to read something about what the Arrowhead Group is doing to help preserve the work of these early pioneers in psychedelic research. A while back, a truckload of documents were shipped to the Arrowhead Center from Myron and Gene Stolaroff by way of John Hanna's van, and since then, a lot has happened. And I asked John to give us a little update, and here's part of what he had to say. I just today sent off the remaining couple dozen or so reels of audio tape for transfer. Last time I did this, it only took about a week until I got them back. The cost for completing these transfers is going to be around $1,000. It might be good to mention that figure when encouraging people to make targeted donations for the project on your show. You are also welcome to mention the fact that these recordings will be featured in future episodes of the Psychedelic Salon, and that they are a unique and valuable flashback to earlier times, an important part of our psychedelic history. And I guess I should add that one of those tapes that John found is an interview that Myron conducted with Dr. Humphrey Osmond back in 1964. You remember Osmond, I'm sure. He was the man who actually coined the word psychedelic. And I'm really looking forward to the day that you and I can hear this conversation here in the salon. Now, if you are an Arrowhead member, you also receive their print publication, Arrowhead Extracts. And in the next edition, here is what they'll be saying about the Stolaroff collection. In February, Arrowhead received scans of all the items that were sent to professional scanning services from the Stolaroff collection. Nearly 5,000 unique items were digitized. The original paper documents have been returned, and most remain stored at Arrowwood Central until a time can be arranged to deliver them to the Stolaroffs in person. A small portion of the collection, about 350 private letters, was removed and shipped by request to the couple who penned them. A disc of all scanned materials is also provided to Myron's daughter, Harriet. Along with the text materials, the Stolaroff collection includes a couple dozen reel-to-reel recordings, many of which are unlabeled. To test the feasibility of digitally archiving these, sample reels were sent to two companies specializing in audio data transfer. One of the reels contains a November 1, 1964 interview that Myron conducted with Humphrey Osmond. The second reel contains a non-dated trip report in which Myron describes the first time he took a 200 microgram dose of LSD. Unfortunately, while both companies did a reasonable job in transferring the recordings, there were some challenges. Although losses and audio gremlins are to be expected on magnetic tape that is over 40 years old, the sound levels were quite low and marred by distracting hum or buzz. Hoping to produce something a bit better, Arrowwood passed the discs along to volunteer Jay Rizos, who remastered them and was able to boost the levels and remove much of the buzz. The resulting sound quality, while not perfect, is substantially better and more pleasant to listen to. As this issue of Extracts goes to print, we have sent the remaining reels out to be digitized, and will then have the files cleaned up as needed. Eventually, this audio will be published online, linked through the Myron Stolaroff Character Vault. We'll keep you posted. Arrowwood now looks forward to the next step in making the Stolaroff collection available online, the development of a keyword searchable database with abstracts for each document and audio file. Donations toward this phase of the project can be made at arrowwood.org/donations/project_stolaroff.php. And I'll be sure to put a link to that in the program notes for this podcast. So if you are in a position to help with this work, I'm sure that future generations will be forever grateful to you. And by the way, to help, it doesn't mean that donating money is the only way to do so, because that would eliminate almost everybody I know. Things are really tight for all of us right now. I know that too, but what you can do is the same thing that I'm doing, and that's spread the word. You never know who you might tell about the Stolaroff collection that may just be the person whose next-door neighbor is the one to put the fun drive over the top. As I've said before, we're all in this together, you know. Well, that should do it for now, and so I'll close today's podcast by reminding you once again that this and most of the podcasts from the Psychedelic Salon are freely available for you to use in your own audio projects under the Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share-Alike 3.0 license. And if you have any questions about that, just click the Creative Commons link at the bottom of the Psychedelic Salon webpage, which you can find through psychedelicsalon.org. And I guess I should mention that I've now completed the revision of the Notes from the Psychedelic Salon blog, which you can find via psychedelicsalon.com, .net, .org, or .us, all of which will redirect your browser to matrixmasters.net/salon. In the past, that blog was located at matrixmasters.net/blogs, but that is no longer an active website for me, and I have left it in place because there are so many links into it that I don't want to break them all. But if you bookmark that address, you may want to change it or just use one of the Psychedelic Salon addresses, because they'll always be pointing to the current site should I ever have to relocate it again. And I should also mention that if you're interested in the philosophy behind the Psychedelic Salon, you can hear all about it in my novel, The Genesis Generation, which is available as an audiobook that you can download at genesisgeneration.us. And for now, this is Lorenzo signing off from Cyberdelic Space. Be well, my friends.
Yes, well, it is an ambiguous enterprise and fraught with contradiction, but forward, ever forward.